So this is my dog. I love this dog, and he's a very handsome Brittany Spaniel, right? He's a hunting dog. What would you call a bird dog? Right there in that picture, I asked him to come down from the pool table, and he would not. he's a handsome king. And so I got this dog because I wanted to train him to become a bird hunting dog. I love bird hunting, and when I bought him, he came with some surprises that were even better than what I thought. This dog not only hunts birds, finds birds, he actually hunts flies too. He's really good at it. He can see a fly from 10 yards away on the wall. If there were 10 doo-doos in the backyard, one fly per doo-doo, he would find 11 flies. I hate flies. I hate them. And I'm so glad that God brought me a dog that could hunt flies as well. Well, in order to train a bird dog to hunt, you need a couple things. One thing is a bird, a dead bird, a real dead bird, not a live bird. We're not training cuddle buddies, right? I mean, we're not going to use stuffed animals or toy or like different stuffed toys. We're not training cuddle buddies. We're training bird dogs. And so in order for me to train my dog, I use this dead bird for retrievals and different things, but the primary thing I used this bird was I took the wing, I tied it to a line on my fishing pole, and obviously, if you hunt, you fish too, right? So I casted my line out, and I took that, I wiggled that wing and around some brush, and I had my dog come out. Once my dog spotted that wing, he pointed, and that's exactly what I was looking for. I wanted to do that so that I would enact or withdraw a point from my dog. I taught him different things. I started him on come, which is the most important. Come is heel. Sit, stay. The most important ones were hold. I taught him to hold. Hold is a very important command, because when a dove dog finds and spots a bird, you need it to hold and stay really still. I can have my dog hold. I can have Bear hold. I can pull him on a leash and he wouldn't move. That's how good and well you need a trained dog to hold, bird dog. You also need to train him how to find things. Send him out in the field and find it. I taught him this command, and every time I tell him to go find something, he sprints out in the backyard or sprints out in the field, and I don't even know if he knows what he's looking for sometimes, but he does find some things. I took him through a field a couple weeks ago in order to flush out some birds. I told him, hey Bear, go find a bird, go find the group of dove. And he went out, and once he found a group, he would spot it. And I told him, hold. Then I inched up closer to that group until I was in range. And once I was comfortable, I told him, okay. And Bear leaped into that dove group and spooked the birds up. If I had a shotgun, I would have taken some birds down. That's how close I was. Easy. Bear was able to do this about 8 or 9 different times. It took 2 years to get him to that point. I was never able to get him from point A to point B overnight. It's impossible. You know, why am I telling you all this stuff about how to train a bird hunting dog, right? Like, what's the point? Well, a bird dog and his master actually work together in order to be successful. So that relationship between a bird dog and his master is actually familiar to a relationship between God and his children, God and his followers. See, it's a very important that we understand that when we train our dog to do certain things, we do that in order that we can become successful. And God trains us in the same way. He trains us so that we are prepared and able to do the work or to receive the blessing that he has for us. He sends us through trials. In James 1, 1 through 4, it says, It'll take a little while, I guess. 1:1-4, it says, "Count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds. For you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness. And let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, not lacking in anything." So you might be wondering, you know, why does God send me through these trials? Well, it is because he's wanting to produce in you steadfastness and test your faith, of course. God sends us through these different trials and valleys in order for us to, he wants us to work on three different platforms. These platforms are faith, faith, hope, and character. You know, just like with our hunting dog, with my hunting dog, I brought him into training grounds that he was able to, with conditions and environments, that he was able to focus on me while I trained him before he was field ready. God does the same thing with us. See, he shepherds us into these valleys in order that we will be field ready, in order that he will prepare us, in order that he will strengthen us and do his work in us, so that one day we would be able to come out and handle whatever he has for us. God does that because he shepherds us into these areas where we are most vulnerable and more apt to have our focus and our dedication to God. These valleys don't, like, when he brings us into these valleys, it takes time too. It's not like it happens overnight, just like when we train our dogs to do things from point A to point B. It doesn't happen overnight. It does take time. And God wants us to invest in him while he brings us in these valleys. How many of you seen Iron Man? Well, there's this one scene in Iron Man where he is putting his suit on, and his smart computer is helping him out, kind of calibrating different things within the suit. And Iron Man tells Jarvis, his smart computer, "I'm going to fly. I'm ready. I'm going." Jarvis says, "Wait, I'm not done yet." And then Iron Man responds with a quick, "You know what? Sometimes you got to run before you can fly." Well, that's our society today. You know, we like to jump right into the position or an exam or whatever, with hopes that we would through osmosis somehow regurgitate a skill or information in order for us to be successful, even if we have not had any experience at the time prior. I can't tell you in college how many times I went to class and like went to an exam and passed it without studying for it. Mostly because I've never passed an exam I didn't study for in college. You know, some of us can do that. Some of us have a knack for doing that. But it really does take time. It takes study. It takes preparation. My cousin Justin just studied for his DAT, and he spent 2 or 3 months working on this exam, like working on this test. He couldn't just come up with this information and regurgitate it just out of thin air, right? No, he didn't know anything about it until he studied for it. Just like that, we need to remember that in our valleys, we need to seek God and focus on God and invest in the valley that he has us in. See, he doesn't want us to worry about the future. He doesn't want us to worry about tomorrow. He says he's got that. He has that. He wants us to worry about today. Focus on what he's teaching us today in order that we can be successful and ready for what we have tomorrow. Even Abraham Lincoln, I think Abraham Lincoln said it best when he said, "The best thing about our futures is that it comes one day at a time." One day at a time. Well, that's so true. Because when we invest in our futures, we think about the future, but we don't, I mean, we worry about today. We get today handled before we can go back in tomorrow. And when Jesus preached a sermon, actually, about this in Matthew chapter 6, he said, worry about tomorrow because, or worry about today because I got tomorrow. Well, I'm talking about these valleys. What do these valleys look like? And where are they? How do you know to watch out for them? There's a man in the Old Testament, his name is David, King David. He was king over Israel and Judah for a long time. He was actually, before he was king, God brought him down to some valleys. And actually, while he was king, he was in valleys as well. But God prepared him in this valley. He wrote about these valleys. He wrote an account, and he put these accounts in a book called Psalms. One of my favorite Psalms, actually, is Psalms 23. And now, you know, I'm not a bandwagon jumper. I love Psalms 23, not because of the popularity. It says in Psalms 23, "For the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod, your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, and my cup overflows. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever." You read that and you go, well, gosh dang, I want that too. You know, I like that. Bring it on. I mean, can you picture yourself just like having God lead you beside maybe a lake shore, and the water's quiet and calm and peaceful, fish are jumping, you know, it's the morning, and you have this, and you're sitting on a lawn chair with thick green turf grass, a luxury here in El Paso, the desert, a luxury. And then you're just in total comfort. You have people massaging your head with oil. You have waiters coming at you with food, with drinks, with lemonade, tea, Arnold Palmer's. I mean, how do you not want that? That sounds really, really nice. This is what David is talking about. Now, the thing that throws you off, right, we kind of subconsciously skip over this verse. The valley of the shadow of death. What does that mean? Right? Well, you think of that, you look at that, and you see all these tangible things, and you look at that valley of the shadow of death, and you're like, that seems a little bit uncomfortable, God. I'm going to keep that, you know, whenever I need it, I'll come back to that. It's a little uncomfortable. I'll take the tangible things that are really nice and comfortable. I'll take the water, the head massages, the oil. I'll take that, but kind of leave that verse away. You know, it kind of begs the question, if a valley of death can be mentioned in a psalm with a lot of blessing, right, then what do these valleys really look like? Are these valleys trials? And what blessing is found in them? What blessing is found in that? How many of you have heard of a story in the Old Testament where it talks about Moses, pharaohs, pyramids, flies, locusts? I hate flies. Moses and Pharaoh, there's a very important story there. Moses brought Israelites, which were a slave at the time, God's people, were slaves in Egypt. He sent Moses down there to ransom those slaves through a series of plagues and flies and all that kind of stuff. And Pharaoh his heart was hardened, frustrated, so pissed off at the whole situation that he finally let the people go. And there's a whole story about that. Go to the map real fast. So there's a whole story about that. And, you know, people think, well, I mean, that's great and all, and I guess that story ends right there, right? That story ends when the people are let go. Yeah, we're all excited. Well, actually, no, that's kind of the midpoint in the story. See, God sent Moses to get the people out of Egypt in order for them to travel to a land called the Promised Land, which he promises people, where they would be their own nation, their own country. Well, you think that it'd be an easy way to get there, right? Like, after Moses took the Israelites out of Egypt, ransomed them out of Egypt, or what have you, so Egypt is right there where all that water is draining out into the river from the ocean, and then Israel is up there, kind of above that, all that. It cut off. But Israel is above there. It's at the top on that other side. And you think that I'm not an expert with maps, but you think that the quickest way and easiest way to get from Egypt to Jerusalem or the Promised Land would be to follow the coast, right? That sounds pretty simple. I mean, you get bonfires at night, you get to go fishing at night. I mean, the ocean's right there. Food, possibly water, an easy trek instead of a harsh desert, right? And you think that God would command Moses to say, "Hey guy, okay, I want you to go follow the coastline up to the Promised Land, okay? How's that? Sound good?" Well, no. God didn't do that. Not at all. God didn't want him to go north. He wanted him to go south. South. Okay, next slide. So if we go to Exodus 14, 1-3, Moses had just brought the people out of Egypt, out of bondage, out of slavery, and then they're heading up to Jerusalem. Well, then the Lord said to Moses, "Tell the people of Israel to turn back and encamp in front of Pi-Hahiroth between Midgal and the sea, in front of Baal Zephon. You shall encamp facing it by the sea, for Pharaoh will say to the people of Israel, they are wandering in the land." So I'm paraphrasing here, but God comes to Moses and he says, "Okay, Moses, what I want you to do is, I know you're going up to the Promised Land, but I want you to turn back. I want you to kind of circle around a bit and look lost. And then I want you to camp at a sea, and is that fine with you? We need that to happen." And Moses is probably going and stepping back and saying, "Wait, you want me to go lead the people back south instead of going north? You want me to go south, and you want me to mill around for a bit? That's the plan? How about we're lost? You want me to seem lost? How about we are lost? How about this strategy? It seems so ridiculous. What does it mean? Like, why would God want the Israelites and Moses to go south when they need to go north? When there's a crystal clear road going to Jerusalem, and God doesn't want them to take that road. He wants them to go south. He wants to shepherd them into a valley. See, God is bringing them into a valley. He wants to bring them in. Why does it seem sometimes that God comes into our life and intervenes and seems like he's just messing things up? Why does it seem like that? Well, he tells us, actually. He tells us in Exodus 13, verse 14. "When Pharaoh let the people go, God did not lead them by the way of the land of the Philistines, although that was near, for God said, lest the people change their minds when they see war and return to Egypt." So, you know, God knew. So the Promised Land was near to the Philistines. God knew that the Philistines were a mighty nation. They were warriors. And Israelites, they were slaves for centuries. See, if the Israelites went over to try and occupy a land that the Philistines were around, there would be war. And the Israelites, they weren't ready for that yet. They just weren't ready. They weren't ready to take on that. It's like you have a football team, a bad football team with no coach. and they go up against someone great, what happens? Well, that football team with no coach, no training, no preparation, no unit cohesion goes up against a football team who is great. God, they're gonna be bashed. They're gonna fail. They're gonna lose the game. Easy. It's like, you know, yeah, they might, the Israelites, that football team, they might have some scattered talent, but you need more than talent to win a football game. It's like in the movie Zorro, when Don Diego says to Alejandro, "You would have fought bravely, but died quickly." See, God was bringing those Israelites back down, keeping them away from the promised land. He was shepherding them down to the valley. Not because he didn't want them to get there, but they just weren't ready yet. You know, they just weren't ready, and they wouldn't be able to handle what God was going to give them. So some of you are wondering, like, why am I in that valley? Well, maybe you're just not ready. Maybe you're just not ready yet. Maybe God hasn't made you ready. You know, why does he do that? Why does he lead us down? He wants to strengthen. He wants to coach us. Just like I trained my dog in different situations, I wanted to coach him. He wasn't ready yet to go out on the field. Sometimes God needs to forge in us character, because we need that in order to handle the blessings or job that he is going to give us. You know, we ask, you know, why do you do this? Prime example right here is King David. God comes to David one day. David is a teenager. He comes to David one day, and I'm paraphrasing here again, but he says to David, "David, I want you to become king." And David's probably like, "Heck yeah, dang right, I want to be king. I'm going to be king." And so he gets excited, gets pumped up. He goes out. He slays this giant, crazy guy named Goliath, big, giant Philistine, cuts him down, and then he gains popularity. He becomes famous, and then he becomes the head of the military. Then he marries into royalty, right? And then all of a sudden, he's a step away from becoming king. He's almost going to be king. And then what does God do? He takes a David, steps away from being king, and puts him in a desert. What? You're killing the momentum, God. What? You really put him in a desert? Why does he do that? Why stick a David into the desert? You know, David, God does that for the reason that he just wasn't prepared yet. In order for David to move to lead millions, he had to get really good at leading three men, then 30 men, who became David's mighty men. See, God wanted to forge in David character. He wanted to strengthen David's faith. He wanted to make sure David had hope in God. And in that valley, while he was there in that desert, those men, the 30 men that David spent time with, those were called his mighty men. And he was able to make community there, to build relationships with these men. He was able to grow with these men. Those men in that valley, those mighty men, when God brought him out of that valley, those were the men who were going to be in the cabinet, in David's cabinet when he became king. See, David didn't find those men in spite of the valley, God put him in, but he found these men because he was in the valley that God put him in. A lot of the times, God brings us to the valleys in order that he puts people and circumstances in our lives so that we can grow in him and that we can become ready and prepared for the blessing that God has for us there. God wants to forge your character. God wants to grow you. Let him do it. See, God ordained this valley as a preparation and training ground for David. And he wanted to train him there so that he can be able to become king one day and lead his people. Another example is Moses. I like Moses. I keep coming back to him. See, Moses, I mean, he was right there in Egypt when God put him right there in Egypt, right? And you know, he's right there. He must have thought, well, I probably should let my people go. I'm here right now, right? Well, he actually tried to do that. He tried to take on that responsibility, and he found that one of the Egyptians was mistreating a slave, an Israelite slave, and he killed that Egyptian. Well, God took him out of Egypt. Moses was exiled into a desert, into a valley, and God wanted him to get real good at shepherding sheep around in the valley. Why? Because God was going to bring him back to Egypt so that he could get really good at leading his people out of Egypt and leading them out through that same desert. That's why. That's why God brings us into those valleys. You know, God shepherds us in these valleys to forge our faith. We need to let him do it. In God's mercy, he brings us down there. In the second part of that passage, chapter 14, verse. What is that? Where is it? Okay, anyway, it says in chapter 14, for Pharaoh will say to the people, the other one. It says, while he's looking for that, for Pharaoh will say to the people of Israel, they are wandering in the land, and the wilderness has shut them in. And I will harden Pharaoh's heart, and he will pursue them. But see, what's going on here? Like, how crazy does that sound, right? It's like you in a coaching a football team. Okay, guys, come on, huddle up. Okay, this is the game plan, guys. I want you to, when we hike the ball, I want you to run the opposite direction. And I want to kind of run around in a circle for a bit. I'm going to put the sea on one side of you, and I'm going to have an army of mass warriors come on the other side of you. And I want you to be in the spot between drowning and a massacre. Okay, 1, 2, 3. Go on 3. 1, 2, 3. Dang, this plan really sucks. Like, what is God doing here? Why does God do that? Why does God put us in these situations where it seems impossible? Well, he tells us. He actually tells us. He says, I will get the glory over Pharaoh and all his host, and the Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord. See, God's desire to be glorified and our hope and faith in him are not in odds. Like, our faith, when we put our faith in him, God will show us his faithfulness and he will be glorified. So whenever we are in a very hard spot, in an impossible spot, we can know and we can depend on God. And if we have faith in him, that he will see us through, that he will come out, and he will have victory, just like he did over the Pharisees. He tells us again, like, I will get the glory over Pharaoh. See, God wants the glory. And this is why. You know, when he wants us to see his faithfulness in impossible situations, he will be, and he wants us to see that, so he will be glorified. Some of you are wondering, well, why? What is the point of that? Well, here's an example. How many of you know what tight roping is? Tight roping is when you tie one rope from one point, one pole to the other, and you just walk on it like that. French do it, it's kind of popular. And so, one guy comes to you one day and says, hey, I'm gonna tight rope over the Rio Grande. okay, that's cool. I mean, sounds fun. Be safe there. I mean, be safe. I'm going to tie rope over the Rio Grande backwards. Wow, can you do that? That sounds pretty cool. I'm going to tie rope backwards with a blindfold over the Rio Grande. Can you do that? That's cool. I'm going to tie rope backwards over the Rio Grande blindfolded, and I'm going to set myself on fire. You can't do that. How are you going to be able to do that? Really? Everyone would pay to see that. Everyone would want to see that. And when he gets over to the other side, you know how much popularity will that get him? People will Facebook that, they'll tweet that, they'll be on the news. Everyone in El Paso will know about this guy. Well, that's what God is wanting here. God wants everyone to know him. He wants the Pharaoh to know that he is Lord and all the hosts around him. Because when we know that he is Lord, we can put our hope in God. The more faith, the more God is glorified, the more we know we can put our faith in him and our hope in him. It's so easy to see each of these valleys as a valley of death, right? It's so easy to see these valleys as something that's disregarded as uncomfortable and something that we can put on the back burner. But no, it's not a valley of death. These valleys are actually, they have blessing. And in Psalm 23, when you go back to verse 4 and look at that verse again, you can just see the value that God has for you in that verse. Right? You have all these blessings, and then you have a valley where God does his work, where God forges you. That's the most blessing. One of my best friends gave me this book. It's a book on, it's a collection of Puritan prayers and devotions. Really good book. It's called The Valley of Vision, and first page when you open it, okay, I promise I went past the first page. I did read past the first page, but first page is the actual prayer on the Valley of Vision. It goes like this. It says, the Lord, our Lord high and holy, meek and lowly, thou hast brought me into a valley of vision where I live in the depths and see in the heights, hemmed in by mountains of sin. I behold thy glory. Let me learn thy paradox, that the way down is the way up, that to be low is to be high. The broken heart is the healed heart. The contrite spirit is a rejoicing spirit. That to have nothing is to possess all. That the repenting soul is the victorious soul. That to bear the cross is to wear the crown. That to give is to receive. That the valley of place is a valley of vision. Lord, in the daytime, stars can be seen from the deepest wells. And the deeper the wells, the brighter thy stars shine. Let me find thy light in my darkness, thy life in my death, thy joy in my sorrow, thy grace in my sin, thy riches in my poverty, and thy glory in my valley. It made me wonder, could that valley of death really be a valley of death? Are we, you know, I was looking at that verse in Psalm 23 from an ungodly perspective. I wasn't looking at it as a blessing. It is a blessing. When God brings you down to those valleys, He's going to work on you. I love how this Puritan puts it. You know, he says, just like this Puritan, we need revelation on how we view our valleys, how we view the valleys that God puts us in. We need to make the best of the situation and the best of what God is doing in those valleys. We need to invest our time and our day in knowing who God is and knowing why God put us there and working on what and figuring out what God wants to do and letting him sculpture and work on us. You know, how many of you know woodworking? Well, what if some guy who was doing a dresser was going to do a dresser for you, make a dresser, and put a bunch of wood together and just raw wood, never sanded anything, just handed it over, kind of raw product. Nothing. I mean, just, who would buy that? Would you want that? A raw product? Not even sanded? Not even varnished? No. A good woodworker takes time. He draws it up. He kind of figures out how he wants to put this dresser together. He takes wood from specific locations. He knows what wood he's going to use, hardwood, softwood. He makes fine cuts. He gets hardware that would help him, equip him to bring his vision to life. He sands down and sands again wood. He varnishes it. He takes time. He chips away. He polishes it. He stains it. He takes time and he hands it over. Now I want to buy that. See, God is working on us. He brings us down to the valleys so he can sand us down, so he can sand down all the things that we need to work on, so that he can cut off all the things that make us imperfect, so that he can grow and strengthen and build us. Just like in James 1, verse 1 through 4, that steadfastness will make us complete and not lacking. That's God's end result. That's what God wants to do in our lives. Let him do it. Some of us are lost in our valley right now. I know I'm in a valley. If you are a child of God, you can actually find rest and comfort in that verse. I mean, it's bittersweet. You do have a valley of death, right? But then you have God's rod and his staff, and they comfort you. God is enveloping you and holding you. That if we have trust and faith in God, that he's warding off death, holding us, fighting for us. He won't let go. He won't let you see decay. And, you know, God does that. There's a verse in Matthew 11, chapter 28 through 29. It says, "Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." Okay, so God isn't saying, "Come to me if you feel like I might be able to help you out. You know, some of you have some stress and are going through some issues that are really hard. Come to me maybe I can be able to take them. Maybe, just maybe. Just come, see what happens if you want." No, God doesn't do that. He's not saying that. He's inviting us. He's saying, "Come to me. I can give you rest. Come to me with all your problems. Come to me with your issues. When you're in your valley and you feel so desperate and so alone and like nothing is going right and you can't work things out, come to me. I will give you rest. My yoke is easy. My burden is light for you." He says he is gentle and lowly in heart. No matter what we have done, no matter what stains we have, sin, whatever we've done wrong, God loves us and he still wants us to come to him. He's lowly, he's humble, he's meek. There's another passage in Luke 15, 1 through 7. The parable of the lost sheep, Jesus is speaking again here. It says, "Now the tax collectors and the sinners, all who are drawing near to him, and the Pharisees and scribes grumbled, saying, 'This man receives sinners and eats with them?' So he told them this parable. What man of you, having 100 sheep, if he has lost one of them, does not leave 99 in the open country, which is crazy, and go after that one lost until he finds it. And when he has found it, he lays it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he comes home, he calls his friends and family together, his neighbors together, saying to them, 'Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep that was lost.' Just so, I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over that one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance." See, we can be affirmed as believers in Christ that he will help us and he will come for us in those valleys, that he is that he is coming for us with open arms. And if we are lost, he will find us. He will give us hope. He will comfort us. He will put his yoke upon us. Some of us are in a different kind of valley, though. Some of us are in a valley of spiritual death, eternal death. These valleys of death are different, and we need a Savior in them. Jesus is that Savior. Jesus is our God. Jesus can save you. God can save you from these valleys. In Romans 6:23, it says, "For all the wages of sin is death. For the wages of sin is death. But the free gift of God is eternal life through Christ our Lord." That's saying that the wages, what we earn, wages of sin is death. Because of that, we have no result but death. But the free gift of God is eternal life through Christ our Lord. It's free. You don't have to pay for it. Free. I love free things. I don't like flies, though. Okay, so what is sin? Like, what the heck are we talking about here? You know what the law is? Ten Commandments? Or better that, do you know what the law says you should and shouldn't do here? God put the law there not so that we would just, well, for one reason we would obey them, but there's also a more significant reason why that law is there. That law is there so that we can see what sin is. So we have a problem. If we didn't have that law, we think we'd be perfect, right? We're not perfect. That law says we're not perfect, and God says we're not perfect. That's why he put that law there. See, if we are not perfect, then we have sin, and we need a Savior to ransom us out of that. God loved us so much, he sent his only Son, Jesus, to die on a cross for our sin, so that he would pay that ultimate sacrifice, and he would take that sin to the grave. Well, when Jesus was resurrected, he was resurrected with victory over that sin. And if we believe and trust in him that he can save us, then he will save us. And if we repent from our sin and know that Jesus is Lord, then we will be saved and we will be ransomed from that valley of death, of eternal death. If we seek God and we say, okay, you know what, God? I trust you. I know that you are God. Then God will take that valley of death and he will change that around. And he will show us that it's not a valley of death. It's a valley of blessing. It's a valley of vision. It's a valley where he's going to forge character into you. It's a valley where he's going to instill in you hope. And he's going to build faith. He's going to build your faith. You know, it may take time, and it may take hard work. It might leave you breathless at times. But God will, and God will see you through. And he will get you from that valley to the mountaintop. I love how that Puritan states that. How he says that that valley is a valley of vision. God will, if we believe that God will bring us out and that he is there, if we put our trust in him, he will let us see that paradox. Essentially, God shepherds us into these valleys to forge us. Let him strengthen your faith. Let him build your character, forge it, and let him embolden your hope. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for just everything that you're doing in our lives. Lord, I pray that you will give us strength in these valleys and that you would help us to just look at you just like a sunflower follows the sun around, Lord God. Help us to follow you around and keep our focus on you so that we won't miss what you have for us in those valleys, the value. Lord, please bless and strengthen us. Help us to grow in you. And I pray all these things in Christ's name. Amen. Thanks.
Amen to that. For this last song, I'm just going to have everyone stay seated, mostly because this is a song that I'm sure no one knows because we just found out about it this week. But as Lloyd shared the verses from Matthew 11, 28 through 30, this song is titled Matthew 11, 28 through 30, and it's simply those verses put to music. And so as we sing this, I just want you to let these words minister to your soul and just, you know, pray to God during this time. I think we all at some point have some sort of burdens that we're carrying. And you know, in this verse, Jesus is literally saying, come to me, lay your burdens on me, take my yoke, which is easy and light. And so during this time, just let these words minister to you.
And again, this song wasn't written by us. It was written by a young man by the name of Kurt Vernon.
All who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Come to me, all who labor.
My yoke is easy, my burden is light.